Okay, good evening, everyone. Welcome to the regular business meeting of Reading City Council here on Monday, January 8th. I'm sorry, this is Wednesday, January 10th, 2018. It was delayed because of the weather. We're going to open today's meeting with the invocation. Councilman Twyman is going to do that for us, and we're going to remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
Today, may we be open to others' ideas and beliefs, respectful of our differences and not threatened by them. May we grow to the understandings of others' motives, knowing that people often act out of their own fears. May we be forces in replacing fear with insight, helping us all to be patient and kind as we talk. Strength, real strength, can always find a compromise. Working together, may we find a common ground, enable us to move forward with a shared purpose. May we see what is truly important and unites us and focus on that. Banish the roadblocks of ego and fear, and today may we all be open to others' ideas and beliefs in our city. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Ms. Van Hinderschitz?
Here.
Mr. Marmarou?
Here.
Ms. Reed?
Here.
Ms. Schehalnick?
Here.
Mr. Slifko?
Here.
Mr. Twyman?
Present.
Mr. Waltman, president.
Here.
Seven present, none absent.
All right, we want to welcome Lucine.
Thank you.
Welcome. I know it's been a... been a fun night already, right?
It has.
See if we can make it more interesting somehow.
Happy to be here.
I'm sure we will. We don't have any proclamations this evening. I'm going to ask someone to read our public comment guidelines. Anybody want to volunteer for that?
Sure. We have three on agenda matters.
All right. We have three on agenda matters, so we will entertain all of them at this time. So, Donna, if you don't mind.
Sure. Citizens have the opportunity to address council by registering with the city clerk. All remarks must be directed to council's body and not to any individual council member or public or elected official in attendance. Any person making personally offensive or impertinent remarks, or any person becoming unruly while addressing council, may be called to order by the presiding officer and may be barred from speaking before council unless permission to continue speaking is granted by the majority vote of council. All comments by the public shall be made from the speaker's podium. Citizens attending the meeting may not cross the area beyond the podium. Any materials to be distributed to council must be given to the city auditor, Dave Sitak, if he'll wave, and he will pass them along. Those commenting on agenda business shall speak at the beginning of the meeting and shall limit their remarks to 5 minutes. Those commenting on general matters shall limit their remarks to 3 minutes. No comments may be made from any other location except the podium. And anyone making out of order comments may be subject to removal. There will be no demonstration, including applause or cheering at the conclusion of anyone's remarks, and citizens may not ask questions of council members or other elected or public officials in attendance.
Okay, thank you, Donna. Our first speaker this evening is Kathy Myers, chairman of the Environmental Advisory Council. Good evening, Kathy. You have up to 5 minutes if you need so.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to speak to you this evening. I am Kathy Curran Myers, for the record, and I am the current chair of the Environmental Advisory Council, often referred to simply as the EAC. I would note that one of the specific charges in the enabling legislation that established the EAC is that the EAC shall advise council and the administration on matters relating to the use of open space within the city. So it seemed appropriate for us to come to you to speak to the ordinance that would authorize the leasing of land within Hampden Park and the Mount Penn Preserve currently dedicated open space for the purposes of outdoor education, outdoor recreation, and natural preservation. And we have provided a letter for you with those remarks. I'm just going to highlight a few of the key points we make in that letter this evening, and of course answer any questions you may have. So first, we fundamentally feel that having reviewed the proposal in general, not really seeing the survey, but having gone to the general area where the proposed site is located in Hampden Park behind the high school and near Alsace Road, we find that a commercial cell tower use is really fundamentally incompatible with those purposes for which Hampden Park and Mount Penn Preserve were created. And so very much encourage you to stick with that dedication. It took a long time to put together such a wonderful tract of unbroken open space and natural area. And to begin to start fragmenting it would be counter to both the public interest and the environmental vitality of the area. We would point out that the steep slope ordinance very likely applies, though we, again, haven't seen the survey and wouldn't know that's an engineering determination, but it's likely the steep slope ordinance applies for the very reason that seems to apply to the situation, that putting equipment and access roads on steep slopes on mountainous areas has serious environmental effects, among them being encouraging landslides, downslope motion, mudslides, fire, wildfire going at increasing speed because of the uphill motion, and water pollution and erosion problems downslope. So because of all those reasons, there are a lot of restrictions that would be applied to this relating to preservation of trees and extra efforts to limit impacts on water and erosion control and stability. So we just point out that those are important considerations. This area of Hampden Park was named one of the highest value ecologically important areas in the city that we have in our open space, and part of the reason for that is its proximity to our elementary school, middle school, high school, and college all along Hampden Boulevard, and this area is right behind there. So this is the area of Hampden Park and the Mount Penn Preserve that is most accessible for our students from kindergarten right through college students. And the college community students regularly go in this very area. I personally go out there on the many hiking trails, and I see them gathering biological data and getting to study the forest there. So this is the area easiest for our youth to use. There are many hiking trails that are accessible from the Hampden Heights area, and it's well used by the youth. That also has a downside. It's good because it's a wonderful environmental classroom, and you can get there from the high school and from the college and from the schools. But it also means the youth can get there, and it's an attractive nuisance kind of thing. It's right in the area where a wildfire started only last year or the year before. So again, it's an area where there youth will be youth, and it's worrisome to have an installation like this that close to the high school. Finally, I would just mention a public policy point. One of the, having been in public policy previously, one of the struggles one always has is whether to allow a particular project to be an exception to the purposes and to the original plan, the original strategies for land use in the area. And a small site, this is a relatively small site, this is not a huge big deal, but if you allow a 175-foot cell tower to be put in this nature preserve, in this viewscape, how do you then deny other uses? And what you end up typically having to do is approve other similar incursions, and it's very difficult to deny future uses, and you end up with fragmentation. So thank you very much for your patience. Our entire remarks, were circulated to you.
Thank you, Kathy. Our next speaker is Chris Schubert, and the topic is Monopole. Chris, good evening, sir. You have up to 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. President. Again, Chris Schubert here as the attorney on behalf of EcoSite. And I had the opportunity at the break to hand out some photographs of the cell tower site that I had mentioned in my comments at the Committee of the Whole meeting. This was a cell site installation that was put in place in Upper Bucks County back in the early 2000s. And the photographs, I think, bear out exactly what I was trying to convey to the council members, that with the proper siting of these cell phone towers, that they really can be compatible and have very minimal aesthetic impact on an area. In this particular instance, we also had to move forward with regard to obtaining zoning relief. This was actually a cell site location that was on private property where the municipality was not gaining any benefit. But nevertheless, we still had to move forward with getting zoning entitlements and getting zoning approval. Again, with this installation, if it is designed, and in this instance, we had adopted a color scheme that would be best suitable to the background mountain trees when they didn't have leaves. So in this instance, it was kind of a brown, almost like a gray-brown paint that had been selected specially by the municipality for this installation. When the pole was put in, I think everybody was quite pleased with regard to how this ended up, again, purely from an aesthetic standpoint. In terms of the issue of why we have cell phones and why people rely upon and need cell phones, I understand that the cell phone coverage in the area of Hampton Park extending up to Mount Penn is not great. There's a lot of gaps in coverage that are suffered not only by T-Mobile, but by the other providers who would operate in this area. So then it becomes a safety issue for your constituents, the same students that the Environmental Council was speaking of. Anybody who's on the hiking trails, anybody who's using those trails in the park, need to have robust communication services, not only for their own personal reasons, but also for public safety issues. I happen to be involved in an application right now in another county, in Chester County, where we are proposing an installation in a public park. These uses are not wholly incompatible with the park type use. Again, in this instance with Hampton Park, you have athletic fields, the football field that has stadium lights, the baseball field that is out there. There has been improvements that have been made in the park, and this improvement will, in my estimation, of course, I'm somewhat biased with regard to it, but I think is not inconsistent with the park use and would provide additional public safety enhancements. And again, this is just the first step in the process that the applicant has to go through. This just opens the door. We still have to put our proofs out there. We have to go before the zoning board. We have to go before all the outside agency approvals that would be required. We do not anticipate any impact on steep slopes given the location where this proposed cell site is to be placed. So from that standpoint, we would hope that council act favorably at this stage on the lease, and we could move forward and then get into further design review and ultimate zoning that would be required for this application. Thank you.
Thank you. Our final speaker this evening is Gina Rose, and the topic is monopole.
Just to let you guys know that this is the first stage, and that basically this is to go into a leasing, and the amount of money that would be paid out in the beginning to sign a lease is like $2,500. And even if we don't go through zoning or don't get approved for the NEPA, the money would still be given in the next 2 weeks from the time you guys signed the lease. And at the end of the day, we've done everything that you guys required us to look into. We've moved from one location to another location to try to do the best to make sure the city of Reading is happy with where the location would be. Even if we sign a lease and we decide that we want to move it and adjust it, we could always do that still. This is just the beginning stages. If you guys are not happy with that location, it's going to take maybe another year and a half till we could even place a tower or construct a tower. You guys could say shift it, you know, over this way. We can't always do that. we have to get coverage in that area because the towers up top where the mountain is, where you see all the seven towers, they basically go straight forward into the town and into Lower Alsace. It does not go straight down into Hampden Park. They're not tilted to go down towards that direction. So one way or another, FCC will allow us to place a tower within that area. If the city can't, does not want to go into a contract with us, we would have to look for other ways. Another thing that is that there's these things called small cells, and that's what a lot of the carriers are doing right now. And once the small cells, they will put like over 50, 60 antennas throughout the city on light with light poles or anywhere they could put them on, and those will be with private, with the, you know, the power company they'll go into contract with, and they'll be all over the city. This is one tower that's been going to be camouflage brown to, and limited trees will be cut, and we will be placing new trees for the trees that we cut down. And on top of that, where we're located is flat land. It's we'll be putting a new fence for the baseball field that's right there with green leaves through them, so they can't even see that. The compound, the fence will be 8 feet high, and it'll be wooded where they can't even look into the compound. So we are doing, and then there'll be landscaping with flowers outside the compound and everything, and we'll donate the trees that we do cut down back to the city. We're doing everything we can do to work with you guys, not only for us with T-Mobile, but, you know, the EcoSite is a tower company. They're not a carrier, so our business is building cell towers. They've already had interest in different carriers to possibly want to co-locate, so there isn't going to be additional towers within that area. Just going to be this one tower. Within the ordinance they have, if you place one tower and another carrier were to come, they would have to go to that tower. It's not like there's going to be five, six towers like the one up top. I guarantee you guys, we don't come in to these places like to, you know, force our way in to do certain things. We are working with the city to make sure you guys are happy with what the, you know, what we plan on doing. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, that completes our public speaking this evening. We're going to move on to the approval of our agenda and minutes. There are a couple changes to the agenda. First of all, we're going to add two resolutions, one to the consent agenda related to an officer promotion. And the second one is going to be added under resolutions regarding the Animal Rescue League. We're also going to be withdrawing, which pretty much means we won't read into onto the record one ordinance that was going to be introduced, and that would be Ordinance B. So that will be withdrawn. And as part of the approval of the agenda for this evening, we will approve the December 18th regular meeting minutes and the following consent agenda items. First would be a resolution appointing five probationary police officers to the Reading Police Department. The second would be a resolution authorizing the disposal of 2010 financial interest and gift forms for the city clerk's office. The next resolution would be authorizing $20,000 in home administrative funding to Urban Design Ventures for home program technical assistance services. And the final resolution under the consent agenda items would be promoting Officer Christopher Kagan to sergeant. So those four resolutions, along with the minutes and our agenda, would be approved unless there's any objection to the approval of those items. There's not, they stand as approved, and we will move on to the administrative report. We welcome the Honorable Mayor Scott and Mr. Steckman for their report.
I know I gotta get this right, so let me think. Lucene, right?
Yes.
Lucene Shelnick?
Sahelnick.
Sahelnick. I always have a hard time when I see you get your name placed right, but I want to welcome you to City Council.
Thank you.
And I just, the only words of advice I can give you, always, you know, do your best. I try my best to keep negativity from being around me and always be positive about where you go. And I always ask people, you know, never vote what you think is politically right, but vote for what is right, and that's it. But it's a pleasure to see you. I think the first time we ran, I ran into you where we did some of your official business was up on Kenhurst Boulevard in your district.
Mm-hmm.
where they just put a whole new street in there, so that turned out very good. And, well, it's a pleasure to see you, okay?
Thank you.
That's all I have. I don't have anything else at this point.
All right, thank you, Mayor.
Briefly, Councilwoman, I invite you to come and meet with me at any time. Several council members take that opportunity, some on a spur of the moment, some with regular meeting times, but so that we can explain to you sometimes in more detail than we get in meetings here, so. Obviously, it's so far, it's been a tough winter a little bit. It's been extremely cold, and we've had snowstorms and not really snowstorms, but minor snow events, but still costs us a lot of money to plow and to salt. But the city is still, the salt barns are being kept full. If this, hopefully, if this weather does not continue, but if it does continue, we have plenty of salt to keep our roads open. So I just wanted to make sure everybody knew that. I also want to announce that the city ladder truck has arrived to be added to the fire fleet. You know, you approved the city to move forward to purchase this fire truck. It took a long time to come from Wisconsin, Chief. It was a long trip across the country. We think, you know, but it is here finally, and we're proud to add it as part of the fleet. Other than that, we will be giving you at your next meeting discussion where we are financially after the, you know, the first 12 months without the accruing back, but our numbers continue to look good. So, and I know that there is a date that needs to be chosen for the presentation of the audit, which is now done.
All right, any comments or questions for the administration? Marcia?
Just a comment and a thanks to the police department. I know we've had issues with people parking and blocking access to the fire trucks, but I've noticed an increased ticketing, and it seems like certain people don't understand that they can't park in fire hydrants, so they've been ticketed multiple times. But I just want, I know the fire department appreciates it, but I think the police department is doing a great job of following through. Also, a shout out to Public Works for the work that they've done in the last couple of snowstorms. And I know we'll be voting on the contract for the Animal Rescue League, but I've also noted them in the neighborhood picking up dogs that were left outside in the cold and following through with what we needed to do with our ordinance there. So it's very much appreciated.
And I'm glad you brought up, the city is going to be continuing the enforcement with the Reading Parking Authority of the blocking of fire hydrants. We actually had some person drive into a fire scene and park their vehicle over fire hoses in front of a fire hydrant. So there seems to be, we're trying to figure out why there's being so much disrespect to making sure that these hydrants are available. You know, obviously we've seen what the extreme cold can do to a fire hydrant, but it is important for people's safety that they keep those, keep away, but we do not want to ticket in tow. But we're encouraging voluntary compliance. We're also looking at people who, for some reason, have decided to pile trash around our fire hydrants, and we're trying to correct that, too.
Go ahead.
Was that car ticketed, that?
Yes.
That was parked on top of the hose? It's okay. Thank you. I appreciate that.
All right. Any other comments? Yeah, I just want to comment on the fire hydrant issue. I mean, we spend in the city, for those who don't know, most of our money in public safety and fire and police. The last thing we need is, in an emergency situation, someone's car to be an impediment to the true, really, need of city government is to provide those safety services. It just makes no sense. And I'll further that, when there is a heavier snow, it's all of our responsibility to help keep those hydrants clear. So that when they are needed to be accessed, people can get to them, the firemen specifically, rather quickly. Because seconds are lives. I mean, that's the bottom line.
Yeah, and I guess my comment was, I've lived in my neighborhood for 30 plus years, and this is the first time that I've seen cars towed that have illegally parked in that fire hydrant. So it's a real difference.
And I might just add also that, I mean, this is the cold season. This is the fire season, too. I mean, I've heard a lot of fire sirens in the last couple of weeks, and it's the most dangerous time of the year. I'm sure the chief can corroborate that. So we do absolutely need to keep those fire hydrants open. And I also would like to compliment the city on the snow removal job. I've heard some good comments from a number of citizens here that, you know, that it was a prompt, and compared to the suburbs, it was better. So that's good.
And I'd also like to compliment, I just realized, I forgot Bill Murray was back there. Rawa has been experiencing a number of water breaks and will continue because of the intense freeze and the heaving that will come with the softening up of the ground. So they have a busy season ahead.
Okay, thank you. We're going to move on to the report from our auditor, Mr. Sitek. Good evening, sir, and welcome.
Thank you, Council President. Good evening, one and all. I'll try to be brief. Updates on admission fees or taxes. We received over $6,300 from the Reading Fighting Phils for November's advanced ticket sales, and including that was over $1,300 from the Christmas at the Stadium during November. Obviously, December numbers aren't in yet. Between the Performing Arts Center and the Santana Arena, we received over $66,600. Major performances held by Mark Anthony, University of Miami, basketball game, obviously with Lonnie Walker, Perfect Circle, Cirque Holidays, Jennifer Nettles, just some of the variety of performers. We also received over $3,300 for the Reading Royals for November sales. As of the November 30th, benchmark $526,251.52. We only expected $425,000, so that's a $100,000 variance to the good with the month of December yet to come in. Another good piece of news, real estate transfer tax. There were 179 properties sold in November, 141 were taxable. Taxable yield $309,954.88. Through end of November, $3.7 million. Budgeted was $2,750,000, and we upgraded that from originally $2,500,000. So we're practically $1 million ahead of budget again on the revenue side, and the month of December is yet to come in. And lastly, similar to the administration, I would like to congratulate our newly elected Councilwoman Lucine Salnick and our re-elected officials, Council President Waltman, Councilwoman Reed, Councilman Marmaru, Councilman Slifkow, and along with the incumbent members of Council Administration. Look forward to working with them to make Reading a better place to live and work. And as a side note, I believe we are trying to schedule for the next Council meeting of the 22nd of January, the 2016 City Audit. I think that's what we're trying to do, and we'll double check.
Can we distribute the draft in advance?
That's what, yeah. We should have that by, hopefully by tomorrow.
Thank you.
Electronically. That is my report. I'm open for questions.
Okay, any comments or questions for the auditor? All right, if not, David, thank you for your report.
You're welcome.
We're gonna move on to ordinances for final passage. Our first ordinance this evening is authorizing a utility easement at the Masano property at 1015 Lancaster Avenue. This was introduced at the December 18th regular meeting. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments?
This easement is allowing for the Masano group to expand one of their dealerships. The need is to construct a building over one of our corrugated metal pipes. 72-inch pipe.
All right, thank you, Glenn. Any comments, questions? If not, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Marmaru, seconded by Councilor Reed, to enact Bill Number 1, 2018, which authorizes the execution of a utility easement at the Masano properties on Lancaster Avenue. Ms. Goodman-Hinderschitz?
Yes.
Mr. Marmaru?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Schihelnick?
Yes.
Mr. Slifko?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
Our next ordinance is Bill Number 2-2018. Restricting parking and maintaining the requisite no parking signs along both sides of North 2nd Street in the 0-100 block between Washington and Penn Street, with the exception of 8 parking spaces to be located along the north side of North 2nd Street between Court and Penn Streets. The purpose is to comply with the conditions of PennDOT Highway Occupancy Permit Number 134367 and the Second and Washington Streets Intersection Improvement Project. This was introduced at the December 18th regular meeting. Is there a motion, please?
Move to table.
Second.
All right, it's been properly moved and seconded to table. There is no discussion on a table motion, so Linda, we're going to ask for a roll call, please.
Motion was made by Counselor Goodman Henrichs, seconded by Counselor Slifka, to table Bill Number 2, 2018. Mr. Marmarou?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Schelnick?
Yes.
Mr. Slifka?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman Henrichs?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
Seven yeas, no nays.
All right, our final ordinance for passage this evening is Bill Number 3-2018, authorizing the execution of a lease agreement for the installation of a monopole for T-Mobile within Hamden Park, near the baseball field located at the vicinity of Alsace Road. This was introduced at the December 18th regular meeting. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments? John, then Glenn.
You have heard from the Environmental Action Council and received letters from both that group and Burke's Nature, all in opposition to the location of a cell tower at the base of or within Mount Penn Preserve. To these comments, I would like to add the following. When I first came to Reading 34 years ago, I was and continued to be very much impressed by our mountain, a green oasis in the midst of dense urban development. Not only did the mountain impress me, but the fact that there was this clear delineation between developed land and a state of nature, a delineation that has been called a magnificent backdrop to our fine city. It is truly one of the great icons of the city, a unique defining feature that makes Reading, Reading. We are so fortunate to have that. Just as New York City has its Central Park, in Chicago, it's Lake Michigan. And yet this great treasure did not come about by accident, nor are we now permitted ethically to compromise it or to allow in any way for its slow erosion. Our far-sighted predecessors at the Reading Water Bureau 90 years ago, the Clinton Earl Trust throughout much of the last century, the Berks County Conservancy, now Berks Nature, and most recently, this City Council and the County Commissioners through their preservation of Antietam Lake. All these groups labored and sacrificed so that this treasure could be acquired and then preserved for all future generations. We cannot breach our trust with them. But if we allow this cell tower, we will do just that. A monopole 150 to 175 feet high will stretch visually a third of the way up the crest and be the first development of its kind or any kind on the face of the mountain. It will affect not only those in the immediate vicinity, but even those at a distance, looking across at the mountain from 6th, 8th, 10th, and 12th streets, and from Spring, Robeson, Marion, and Perry. Of even greater concern is the precedent that will be set by allowing this first significant development against the face of the mountain. Once one cell tower is established and other wireless providers co-locate on it, what is to prevent other towers along the base of the preserve or even development of another kind? The argument has been made that if we deny this lease, we will somehow be impeding technological progress in Reading. That is simply not true. There are alternatives. If the problem is lack of cell coverage in the Hamden soccer field, as T-Mobile says it is, then a simple relay antenna attached to an existing light standard could accommodate that. If the problem is lack of cell capacity throughout the city, our zoning ordinance provides for tower locations throughout the Norfolk Southern Corridor and at other sites greater than 500 feet from a residential district. Finally, and I don't know why this wasn't brought to Council's attention before, let's look at what our zoning ordinance, the law of the city, says about the proposed T-Mobile location in Hamden Park. It is clear that on at least three counts, this tower at this location is prohibited. 2106B6. No communications tower may be placed within 1,000 feet of any preservation district. This proposed location is within a preservation zoning district. No communications tower may be placed within 500 feet of any residential zoning district. This site is less than 500 feet from an R3 residential district. Finally, height of tower not to exceed 100 feet where tower use permitted, except a 200-foot height shall apply in the heavy manufacturing district. The proposed tower is 150 to 175 feet tall, and it's certainly not in the heavy manufacturing district. However, despite this strong ordinance, the zoning hearing board could grant a variance if we lease this land to T-Mobile. Furthermore, T-Mobile could move its proposed location 75 feet up the mountain, and the site would still be on city property, but in Lower Alsace Township, and therefore not subject to the City of Reading ordinance. For that reason, we should deny the lease of any city land to T-Mobile to ensure that a cell tower location does not slip through our zoning regulations. For all of these reasons, the violation of our zoning ordinance, the degradation of a priceless treasure when alternatives are available, and above all, our duty of stewardship to generations past and future, for all these reasons, we should not lease any city land for cell tower use anywhere on Mount Penn Preserve or along its base. Thank you.
Glenn. When this was proposed to the city administration, the city administration thought long and hard about this. Because unfortunately, no matter what, cell phone towers, wireless towers can be an eyesore. And the administration looked at it, how do we make this the least of an eyesore? The tree stand up there is typically about 80 to 100 feet. To have the capacity, they needed to extend over the tree stand, but we felt as an administration it would be a relatively hidden compared to where they possibly could build one, which was in the Norfolk Southern track area. And the administration worked, I think, very closely with the council. I know that the development people worked very closely. They had met with you up on those sites to find the least obtrusive area. Council Marmaru, in fact, was there many times to make sure that it would create a situation that would be less obtrusive. If, you know, you heard this evening that if they located in the Norfolk Southern site, that cell tower would be well over 200 feet with a strobe light of some sort on top of that, so everybody in the city, they can see where the tracks will be seeing where a new cell tower is located, which will be obviously very intrusive into people's lives, because now they're going to have flashing lights all through the night and possibly day going on and off, because it will be in the flight pattern possibly of the Reading airport. So the city administration tried to make what we considered the best deal in the interest of the city of Reading. I want to let you know that it is very possible that that cell tower will bring in over $765,000 into recreational programs over the next 20 years. And that's not an insignificant amount of money, for a city that is always struggling and looking for money, especially for recreational purposes. And that's why the administration went forward with this. We felt that the location was the best location, that was less obtrusive, and also provided a positive impact for the children of Reading through the recreational designation of those funds.
Additional comments? Brian.
I was a part of the location finding a spot that seemed suitable for a cell tower that seemed least intrusive to me. Although John's comments are very, very important, I usually err on the side of Mother Nature. But in the future, it seems that for the safety of our children, which is one of the things mentioned several times in the use of the mountain, it's going to be very important that there is some kind of location where signals can be used and technology can be used. And our future tends to lean on the side of technology either way. It's a hard decision for me, and I will mull around it still for the years to come and the future to come. It will need to be run through committee, zoning and planning, and I hope that everyone takes the time to really debate it and talk about it, and we will still have time to revisit it as city council people. So my feeling is that I will probably err on the side of technology this time, only because it may be an inevitable thing. And I believe that we need to be progressive to some extent, that we're not causing ourselves to go behind and just miss an opportunity. And just the opportunity is that our city continues to be able to provide our residents and our people what they need. If another location is chosen, I hope that we all consider all the factors that need to be taken into consideration here. It's still a hard decision for me. I'm going to continue to really think about it. But I believe that they tried to be as least intrusive as possible. A few trees, numbering, I believe, less than five will be damaged here. And I hope that we can readdress this issue as soon as possible. And I hope that planning and zoning take the time. And consensus will help me make the decision in the end.
Additional comments, Donna?
First of all, I want to thank the gentleman. You've gone out of your way to work with us, and I appreciate that. I think it's, and this council has gone there and walked the walk, literally, to see the placement and the adjustments. And I say this with due respect, as someone who fought long and hard more than a dozen years ago for the preservation of Antietam Lake, I have to err in that. I'm not erring on that side. I'm staying with preservation. And again, I respect your efforts, and I hope that an alternative site can be found that works. But John said it well, and I cannot, in good conscience, vote for this location.
Additional comments? Marcia?
This is an interesting place for me to be, because we did go through many locations, and I have always been someone that supports preservation, and I think the compromise that we came with this location does both support preservation. It is not located on the steep slopes at this point. I was not able to join Councilman Timon when he went up, but I did go up on my own to be able to see the location. Indeed, it's located very close to where the tennis courts are, which is a highly lit area. So when we look at where our preserve actually starts with the mountainside, it is indeed above this area. The other thing that I believe is interesting and was pointed out previously is we have a lot of young people and a lot of people using these trails. And I indeed have walked through the trail as it comes down off of the Pagoda, down up into Redding High. They're very steep trails, and they're trails that are very rocky. And there are trails that you can have injuries occur. And if you have that happen and you don't have access to a way to be able to get help for yourself, my cell phone at this point does not work on those steep slopes because of the lack of access to cellular service. I feel much safer knowing that we would be able to have a tower that is in a situation that's not up on the steep slope, but still can give cell phone reception to those young people. And in fact, I know from my district that the young people have discovered that there's an easier way to get to Redding High from East Redding, and that's to walk over the mountain. And so that's what some of them are now starting to do. And so I think we have to recognize that as we open up the preserve, and the land is still going to be preserved. It's not like we're taking it and we're ruining all of what our forefathers have committed to. It's not like what was going to happen with the whole situation with Antietam Lake. Okay, it's way different than this. We're putting up a small tower that is not going to be intrusive. That's going to be very close to existing lighting and an existing tennis court and an existing ball field. So to me, there's a world of difference in what we're talking about here. We're not destroying all the things that we that our forefathers sought to preserve. We're trying to come to a compromise. And so I'm going to be looking at the fact that I know that zoning is going to be looking at this. There may be a different decision when they look at it, and that, you know, they will be following those things that Councilman Slifko pointed out as far as zoning and making that decision. That's not within our purview. Our purview is to decide whether we do a lease agreement. So I feel that I can come to a compromise here and support this.
Additional comments? Well, I'm going to offer mine. You know, I was kind of mixed on this whole issue, and I'm sitting here tonight, and I'm looking at the diagrams, and I do want to compliment EcoSite team and the administration for really trying to frame this for us in a healthy way. You know, the $40,000 a year is a lot of money that we could use towards recreation. But I also have to step back and look at, you know, the alternatives. If there were no alternatives for this site, if there were none, I'd be hard-pressed to sit here and say, okay, let's do that. And, you know, I talked about the size of this pad before, and even the most recent diagram showed close to 40 by 50 or 60 feet, which is pretty extensive, plus a 12-foot wall. So, you know, I remember we were going to do a development up on Eversink. I forget, somebody proposed to
make
homes, and it was going to be 3 units or 9 trees. You know, that's how you lose 8 trees, 9 trees, 6 trees, 7 trees at a time. And, you know, technology is going to continue to be improved and replaced. And what's here today will be gone tomorrow. Nature, once it's gone, it's gone. So as I step back and I look at this tonight, I'm not in the corner of supporting this model. But honestly, when I hear about the 200-foot tower at the old railroad site, to me that's over. Of course, I know we're going to get revenue from that, but I'm actually excited about seeing my clients. I have the line up, I need to see. This is a tough one. These technologies changing so fast. The needs are going to grow. My hope is that they put some benefits in my policy. Even embed a couple on the top of the tree, kind of conspicuously if possible. But we, you know, and the other thing is the generator and all that. I don't even know the details. We share this land with many others. I know there's people on my block that chase these walls away. I would say, well, how are you going to pay for it? This is their name too. But, so that's my position. If there are any additional comments, now would be the time to share them. Otherwise, we're going to be here for.
Motion was made by Councilor Marmer, seconded by Councilor Gumanerschitz, to enact Bill Number 3, 2018, which authorizes the execution of a lease agreement for the installation of a monopole. Ms. Reed?
No.
Ms. Shalnick?
Yes.
Mr. Slifko?
No.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Gumanerschitz?
Yes.
Mr. Marmer?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
No.
4 yeses. 3 minutes.
All right, we're going to move on to the introduction of new ordinances, and we're going to ask Councilwoman Gumanerschitz.
Oh, okay.
We have on the record for us, please.
Okay, thank you. And Happy New Year, everybody. Ordinance A, approving 3 transfers within the 2017 self-insurance fund budget, $21,000 from line item water sewer main breaks into line item premium payments, $29,000 from water sewer main breaks into line item incurred liability claims, and $350,000 from line item W-C claims medical into line item incurred liability claims. B, amending the city code to correct the definition of...
That's withdrawn.
Oh, that one's withdrawn, I'm sorry. No, that one wasn't with...
Yeah, it was.
Okay. Okay, so then B is the one that we're reading in?
C.
C.
B with withdrawn.
A, C. B is...
Well, no, but that's, I'm reading the one as B. Okay, this, yeah, I'm reading the right one. Yeah, I'll call it C then to make you all pleased with that. Amending the city code to correct the definition of contaminated waste, biological waste, biohazard waste in Chapter 540, tattoo and piercing establishment, Section 540-103, word usage and definitions.
Okay, thank you. We're going to move on to resolutions. Our first resolution this evening is appointing Angela Singletary to the Board of Ethics. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Second.
The proper move is second. Are there any comments?
Very few. Excellent again, John.
Yep.
Excellent. She was interviewed the other week. She knew more about this stuff than the, you know, than the people that have been around here for years. Mm-hmm. And, John, go ahead.
Yeah, this candidate was originally promoted for the charter board. Am I correct?
Right.
Yes.
And, yes.
She would have been suitable to either one, but I think her work experience and her desires pointed more towards an ethics board appointment. So we're very fortunate to have it.
Motion is made by Councilor Marmer, seconded by Councilor Twyman, to adopt Resolution 4, 2018, which appoints Angela Singletary to the Board of Ethics. Ms. Shahelnick?
Yes.
Mr. Slipka?
Yes.
Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Henderson?
Yes.
Marmer?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Mr. Walton, President?
Yes.
Seven.
All right, our next resolution is approving the change of the restaurant liquor license number R-13447, LID number 7065, in the city of Renton for Sombreros Inc. for 702 North 8th Street in Renton. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
I'd just like to comment that I am very excited to see something like this come into my district, which is on 702 North 8th Street. Having another eatery there that just gives options in the center of our city is truly excited for me. And I hope that we as council can all get together and be on board with opening up our minds and our decisions to more businesses being allowed to come into our city, because in the end they are a taxpaying entity that will support us for years to come, and if they're happy and they continue to bring jobs and economic development, I believe it's what we need. So I hope that 2018 is the year of the business, and I will continue to fight for businesses to become more welcomed in our city, and I think the administration is doing a good job with that. I know as council, fellow council people, we all want more jobs and more economic development, and this is just one of the first ways to start. So I know they've been at it for a long time, and I wish them well in their endeavors.
I was very impressed by their business plan. I believe they have other restaurants or other experience. Yeah, and they seem like they know what they're doing. The hours of operation were not going to be late at night. Mostly a more family-oriented location, if I recall correctly. So I support this. I think this is good.
Yeah, and it's already a very rich area for eating. Don't come into the middle of the city as you should. Some really good food there. A lot of good restaurants, and we're lucky to have it.
And I think it's always a positive sign when you see a building that wants, or a business that wants to open up in the city. And I think the most that we can do to encourage that to happen, and certainly the transfer of a liquor license is one of the tools that we have, but we have to keep looking at everything we can do with economic development.
Yeah, I hope they get that 8th Street done in time.
I hope Brian brings us some sample.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
I think we have a roll call with this.
Motion was made by Counselor Twineman, seconded by Counselor Reed, to adopt Resolution 5-2018, which authorizes the transfer of a liquor license to 702 North 8th Street. Mr. Slifka?
Yes.
Mr. Twineman?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman Henderson?
Yes.
Mr. Marmarou?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Sheholman?
Yes.
Mr. Walton, President?
Yes.
Seven yeas, no nays.
All right, our next resolution is regarding the appointment of council vice president. And typically, there would be a nomination in a second. So is there anyone wishing to nominate someone?
Yeah.
I'd like to nominate.
Go ahead.
I'd like to nominate John Slifka.
I'll second it.
All right, there's a nomination on the table. Any kind of threats?
I think, first of all, I want to thank the body for enabling me or allowing me to be vice president the last couple of years. I really appreciate that, and I enjoy the experience. I believe John brings a lot to the table. He certainly has, in the last few years, really put a lot of work into his position, and it's greatly appreciated by all of us. I appreciate the efforts of Councilwoman Goodman Henderson during her years as vice president, rocky though they were occasionally, Mr. Walton in his years, and I believe there's lots of opportunity going ahead. I like the idea of every 2 years, sort of making the change that different people get the opportunity to do this particular job. And I'm just very confident John will serve in it and be a very strong vice president, and will be a good liaison for Jeff with the body as well as with the administration.
Any other comments? Yeah, I'm agreeing with what I said earlier. I think it's important that all of us communicate with the administration. I support John as well. I hope that he'll make the efforts to continue to try to communicate with the administration on the matter and the fact that we do the same.
And the council.
And vote all the way around. We're all on the same. This is not Columbia versus.
Exactly.
This is the death. Anyway, so, and if there's no other comments, Brian?
I hope that, I wish John the best. I like the idea that we all kind of tried to come to a consensus about what would be the process. I think it was verbally said, but not really put in any real harsh conditions. But I think it's a consensus of us that we would like to keep that position moving. 2 years is a good amount of time for someone to be, get conditioned to the position. I'm thankful to all of council and the administration for all I've learned, and I hope to continue learning. And, you know, John, hopefully with your leadership and Jeff's leadership and the administration, we can continue to work together and communicate and do what we need to do for the constituents of our city. So, good luck.
Thank you. There's no other comments? Let me come in a little bit.
I will abstain.
Motion was made by Counselor Reed, seconded by Counselor Marmarou, to adopt Resolution 6-2018, which appoints Counselor Slifka as council vice president. Mr. Twineman?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman Henderson?
Yes. She didn't hear you.
Ms. Goodman Henderson?
I said yes.
Didn't hear.
Yeah.
Mr. Marmarou?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Sheholman?
Yes.
Mr. Slifka?
Abstain.
Mr. Walton, President?
Yes.
Six yeas, no nays, one abstention.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Our next resolution, you don't get heralded very often. The next resolution is appointing the city clerk. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
I move Linda Kelleher to be reappointed.
And Strapp, is that a?
Yeah.
Any comments?
I do want to make a comment.
Yeah.
I just think that one of the things with this form of government, we have to recognize is the importance of the role of the city clerk in ensuring that there's communication that occurs. And there have been ups and downs throughout this time that I've been on council, I guess now going on 14 years. But I think it's, Linda has always been a consistent person for us to be able to rely on for information. And so this is important in a continuation of the role, and I don't know how long you've been city clerk, Linda, but...
February 1st, it'll be 22.
Okay. Obviously someone that really knows the city government.
I said this earlier in the year when we were talking about salaries for a lot of our city staff, and I'll say it again, that we really appreciate what Linda does. I mean, she is the backbone of this council, not only with her institutional knowledge, but her passion, her dedication, amount of work. She has an invaluable asset to this council, and we're very fortunate to have her, and I look forward to having her for at least 2 more years.
I think this proves something in many ways, and sometimes those of us who have been on council for a long time, sometimes there have been rocky periods with interaction with over different issues, and poor Linda's been stuck in the middle of it because there's 7 of us. Even though our faces change, there's still 7 of us. But in many ways, if you really think about it, think of how long Linda has been here, how long different people who sit in this body have gotten to know her, have depended upon her, and the institutional knowledge she has. This is really the recipe for stability in administration. And I say administration in the generic term. And Linda, we thank you for putting up with all of us, but more importantly, the knowledge and the dedication, the long hours you work, and your communication with all of us, because you do keep us.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for everything you've done.
Additional comments?
I have a sweet story I have to share with you.
No.
When Joe was mayor, and usually I don't know where the lawsuit began, but I was in the middle of it. I guess they came by this last night about parking, and they said, "Do you know where she's parked?" And I said, "Well, honestly, on a daily basis, I'm not sure where I don't have to come to." But anyway, that was a long, long ago, and we need our staff, and we all need to improve all administration, counselors that are willing to communicate. I'm going to continue to re-emphasize that this year. Because I think we're getting some things done in the city, and I think we have a chance, if we can improve our communication just a little bit more, we can get some more things done, and it's a vital time. I'm sure if we can continue to hopefully we don't get beat up with something. All right, there are no other comments. We have a roll call, please.
Motion was made by Councilor Slipko, seconded by Councilor Marmaru, to appoint Linda Keller as city clerk. Ms. Gubin-Hinoshitz?
Yes.
Mr. Marmaru?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Shehelnik?
Yes.
Mr. Slipko?
Yes.
Mr. Kleiman?
Yes.
Mr. Walton, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
Okay, our next resolution is authorizing the execution of the Reading 18 Homeless Project PennDOT Reimbursement Grant Agreement. Is there a motion for it?
So moved.
Second.
Properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments?
Yep. I'd just like to make, having this in my district, I'm continually impressed at the work that the 18th Wonder initiative is taking on, and have been working on it for several years now. And it's a board of directors, an advisory board, and a residential community effort that's coming together, which is what we like to see to make things happen. So I'm very pleased to see this.
The money from this grant is going to be dedicated towards ADA handicap ramps at the intersections. And whether this is going to replace existing ramps that were put in years ago, I'm not sure in all of these locations. But I want to make sure the public understands that we are being required by the federal government to upgrade even existing ramps that were installed 20 years ago or even 10 years ago. And this project is going on throughout the city, so this will help save the city taxpayers from having to pay for this. And as you well know, we dedicate a portion of our liquid fuel funds when we do complete street repairs And we also commit community development block grant monies to address these, bringing up our city to make it more accessible for those that have disabilities. But this is going to be an ongoing project throughout the city, probably for the next 15 years to 20 years minimum. So this funding does help us address that need over in that particular neighborhood.
Any other comments? Not that we have a roll call, please.
Motion was made by Councilor Mnuchin, seconded by Councilor Shalnick, to adopt Resolution 8, 2018, which authorizes the execution of the 18th Wonder Grant. Mr. Marmarou?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Shalnick?
Yes.
Mr. Slifka?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Henshitz?
Yes.
Mr. Walton, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
Okay, our final resolution is authorizing the execution of a one-year memorandum of understanding with the Animal Rescue League for Animal Control Services. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Could properly move and seconded. Are there any comments?
This is, as you, an extension basically of a five-year agreement that had expired. The city was unable to at that point because of changeover in the leadership of the Animal Rescue League to negotiate another five-year agreement. This agreement is for $138,473 as the city works to discuss this with the board and the interim executive director.
Any additional comments?
Get up and down.
Do the wave.
A keyboard. I've sat there. I understand what you're saying. I seem to be disappearing this year, but whatever. Okay, just to the administration, I appreciate the fact that we do need to just make a one-year extension, and we need to look at what is important as far as how we get animal protection provided in the city. And I know there's been transitions and there's been some rough times for the Animal Rescue League. So I just believe this is a really important issue. And I have seen, even though, again, they're going through transition, I've seen some positive things happening in my neighborhood for what the Animal Rescue League has been able to do in responding to dogs that have been left out in the brutal cold weather and then being able to take them in for safety. So we want to look at all sides of the story as we move ahead to make a decision. So I support this, but I also support the administration investigating and looking into, you know, the status of the Animal Rescue League.
All right, additional comments? Right.
I'd just like to praise the administration for getting this done. I was worried there for a minute, but confidence restored. Thank you for taking efforts to do this. I just think it's really important, and to have it sitting out there for a while was, you know, just a little concerned. So great job.
Motion was made by Councilor Goodman-Henshitz, seconded by Councilor Slifka, to adopt Resolution Number 9, which authorizes a one-year contract with ARL for Animal Control Services. Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Chalnick?
Yes.
Mr. Slifka?
Yes.
Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Henshitz?
Yes.
Mr. Marmarou?
Yes.
Mr. Walton, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
All right, we're going to move on to our final order of business this evening, and that is council comments. And I'm going to lead it off with our annual tradition here, celebrating the ethnicity of our city. Councilor Marmarou has always given us the distinct pleasure of participating in the tradition of the Salipi Days.
All right. Good. Close enough. I won't correct you this year.
All right. So the first Basilipi is a compound Greek word which means the sweet bread of St. Basil. I'm sorry. St. Basil's feast day is celebrated on January 1st.
St. Basil.
A popular tale reveals St. Basil. Basil.
Basil.
Basil.
Basil. Basil. Basil. It's not in Greek, it's in English.
Jeff says there's a lot of moving parts.
Yeah, the person who knows the less fortunate are facing a loaf of bread containing gold coins outside their door.
So there's no coin in there, then?
Thank you, sir. I forgot the coin.
You did yet?
No, still.
Many Orthodox Christians enjoy the Basilica at home with their families during the New Year celebration. The head of the family makes the sign of the cross on the bread with the knife, saying, "In the name," do this first, "in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen." Pieces are cut in specific order. The first piece is always for the Christ. The second and third pieces are usually for the Blessed Virgin Mary and St. Basil. And the fourth, for the
head of the household.
Head of the household receives the next piece as the rest of the family according to their ages. The person.
Oh boy.
I'm not going to get any.
Oh, many years.
Thank you.
So who's the youngest person here? They get the last piece.
Everyone gets a piece.
And somebody gets the coin.
Yeah. The first couple of ones. Cut them small.
Okay. The first three, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so.
Then the old man gets it.
That would be me.
You.
Who got the coin last year?
I forget who got the coin last year.
Who got the coin last year, Strat? You remember?
I don't know who got it last year.
Chris. I think Chris did.
Chris got it last year.
You might be in the right seat. Uh-huh. Luck rubs off on you.
Who would be next?
Doesn't matter.
Okay, so we're just going to go down the order here then.
We don't have to give our ages.
Okay. I would probably be last.
Those days are over, Jeff.
You're not quite a young man.
No, I'm 40. I'll be 45.
That's the sound of age. Yeah.
You got a rich Jeff. I've known each other.
Well, it's stopped on this piece, so whoever comes next
the mayor. Yeah.
Yeah, we're good on this side.
Oh, yeah.
Maybe you can slide that to the mayor. Mayor, I think you got something special
for me. Nice.
I just missed the coin.
I think every year we say that whoever gets the one of us keeps it, right?
Yeah.
For the next year.
That sounds good.
If you have the coin.
I feel like Santa Claus holding up the first gift.
There you are.
This is good.
Thank you.
Sweet. This is nice.
I'm thinking what the taste is.
It's like honey.
This is good.
Do you have your coin from yesterday? You have your coin?
With me.
I still have mine from the time that I got it.
Oh, she got it the other day.
Mm-hmm.
My mother-in-law made one for us, and I got the coin, so.
That's appropriate.
Right. Well, I need that. I need the luck this year.
Bill.
I think you've got a good luck.
Is there pump enough for them back there?
Cindy, come on.
Bill's
gone. My sage.
All right. You gentlemen, go ahead.
I know what the set is. It is pretty good though.
Delicious.
Rice chat.
What's that?
It's like challah bread.
It does, and sugar. Makes good French bread.
Delicious. And you put butter on it and put it in a pan.
What is the taste? Is like slightly, Marsha says, is it slightly apple?
We're trying to figure out the flavoring.
Slightly apple.
The flavor is.
There's eggs in there, I knew that.
Eggs. But it's not, it's sweet, but it's not sweet.
Yeah, it's good.
Anyway, the way I make my Caesar salad, which you can't do in a restaurant, you need to talk bait. So there's like semi-cooked bait. You know,
should we do it now?
Whichever you cook. Okay.
All right.
Go to the Amazon. Not only the environment, but the community.
Thanks, Donna.
We can respect your decision. It's just a surprise.
I'm sure.
Sorry, I didn't get it. Sorry, it isn't big enough.
Yeah, don't.
I didn't know what Jeff was going to do.
Did you get it?
No, I'm trying to be careful.
All right, so moving along, we're enjoying it.
Basla pizza.
Basla pizza, we're going to open up the council comments. Anybody have any final comments?
Just three really brief comments here. I want to comment on two things in the newspaper today. The first concerns our new council person, who is the country newsmaker of the year. The Reading Eagle chose Lucine for that, nice. For all her work with bringing farm produce to the city and elsewhere, and an impressive resume of the things that Lucine has done earlier in her career. That was very nice. Second thing was a front page article about how downtown development is moving forward, and a total of $1.7 million have been dedicated over the next 5 years to serving as a catalyst for the redevelopment of downtown. Very good news. And finally, sort of on a more personal, neighborly note, one of our foremost citizens in Center Park, Mike Louder, underwent cancer surgery today for thyroid cancer. Quite an extensive operation. I've heard that he is doing well. It's a little bit early, so we all wish Mike the very best. He's an outstanding individual. He's in our thoughts and prayers.
Thank you, John. Additional comments?
I just think to note, even though we're moving from our deep freeze to some warmer weather, fire and ice is this weekend in downtown Reading, starting on Friday night, God bless them. We'll see how that goes through Saturday. I know some of us are volunteering to help out downtown, so it's always an extraordinary event to attend, and there are some indoor events. Hopefully the weather does well, and we'll have some ice sculptures to be able to walk through and go down the slide. I challenge any of my council members, if anyone is willing, with the exception of Lucine, because I don't think it will be good for you, come down and do the ice slide. Uh-huh. I think we can have a lot of fun down there. And Mayor, I hope to see you downtown this weekend, so good times for all.
Regarding the downtown development, I want to just thank the administration because they played a lead role in that, kind of in the background and helped putting that together and building some bridges of trust and allowing those who need to help work with that. And I think that's it's an important component. We all agree that we can do some stuff better downtown as well as to improve the small business owner of all the citizens and the mayor's office. I just wanted everyone to be aware of it. You know, that was an initiative that started early on. with the mayor, and I know Bobby likes to focus on the neighborhoods, which is extremely important, but I also believe that he supports this initiative, and I'm glad he gave us some space to kind of build a better.
And I'm sorry, I wanted to mention earlier, for those of us who worked for many years at the Red Eagle, we lost three key former editors and reporters over the Christmas holiday. Bob Sissa, who covered City Hall for many years in the 50s, 60s, and early 70s. John Kunkelman, who was our city editor for many years. And finally, someone many of you know, Nick Yost, who was one of our main editors. Mostly on the Times side, but then after the merger in 82, was our news editor. So these were three people who, in their own separate ways, understood the importance of independent journalism, of not being the PR people for any business, government body, or individual. And they were real wonderful examples in the profession I like to call my calling in life. The real reason that locally there was fabulous coverage and in-depth and careful coverage of city government, municipal governments, county governments, state governments throughout the years. We will miss them all, and especially Nick. We will be having a wake for him at the peanut bar, at the far end of the peanut bar, where many of us spent many a day back in our recording days. And it's just wonderful to have worked in journalism when journalism was truly the fourth estate and truly a benchmark of democracy here in Reading.
And I'd just like to thank everyone, the administration, fellow council members, and community members for a warm welcome to City Council. And I look forward to the next 4 years with all of you.
Well, incidentally, next year you bring it in.
Okay. Deal.
I was gonna say, really, after tonight's meeting, you feel
like yes.
Any other comments? All right, real quick, our meeting schedule is as follows. We know that our next meeting, the committee of the whole meeting, is going to be next Thursday, January 18th, from 5 to 7. We're going to be doing an interview at that time as well. And then our next regular business meeting will be here on the 22nd. Be seated by a committee of the whole meeting as well, so 5 o'clock. If there is no other business, is there a motion to adjourn?
So be it.
We're adjourned. Thank you.
I have fun on